ดิเลกพอดแคสต์ Politics of Everyday Life เพราะการเมืองอยู่กับเราทุกที่ทุกเวลา
ขอต้อนรับคุณผู้ฟังเข้าสู่ดิเลกพอดแคสต์พอดแคสต์ของศูนย์วิจัยดิเลกชัยนามคณะรัฐศาสตร์มหาวิทยาลัยธรรมศาสตร์พบกันในสเปเชียลเอพิโซดตอน Hot Issue in Thailand and Global Politicsกับพวกเราสองคนครับผมชวินฉันทาลิขิตหรือแก
๊ปและผมปรภัทรนาคบัวหรือข้าวปั้น
พวกเราเป็นนักศึกษารัฐศาสตร์สาขา BIR ชั้นปีที่3ครับ
Hi, welcome to our podcast Thailand in Global Politics มองไทยจากเมืองนอกเปิดมุมมองบริบทการเมืองไทยจากต่างประเทศ You're with ชวินฉันทาลิขิต
And me, Wilaphat Nabua.
This podcast is an English-speaking podcast which will serve you a brief story of politics, economics, and a short journey into the world of international relations, provided to you by the Faculty of Political Science and the Dilek Chaenam Research Center.
So recently, we have heard a lot of news on COVID-19. Just last week, we have hit more than 10,000 new confirmed daily COVID cases for the first time, and it seems we still have a long way to go.On July 20, the government reported 80 COVID deaths and more than 11,000 new cases. Since the pandemic started early last year, there has been more than 400,000 COVID-19 cases and more than 3,500 recorded deaths. Furthermore, the government also extended the state of emergency for 2 months according to the country. The situation in Thailand right now is extremely dangerous.
Accordingly, there has been a lot of unrest targeted at the government for the mismanagement of the crisis.From questionable vaccine procurement to the lack of clear communication. To understand how we reached this point and where we can go from here, today we have invited an
assistant professor,
Charlie Tim, from the Political Science Facility, Thammasat University, who will talk to you about the topic of the COVID-19 crisis in the Mekong region and the management of the crisis from the international political economy perspective. So, hi, Ajahn Charlie.
Good afternoon. Thank you both for having me, and thank you for inviting me onto the podcast.
Yes, and thank you for you too. First of all, how are you now, Ajahn Charlie? Apart from taking your class online, we haven't seen each other since last year. Are you struggling with the government lockdown policy right now?
well, I'm doing fine, thank you. Very fortunate to be able to kind of be isolating at home and just working from home. So although it's an inconvenience, it's not...sort of impacting me as much as it would many other people who are struggling with the lockdown.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate to hear that. I know that it may be hard for the student to learn online, and it has for professor as well to teach us online.
Well, I do feel very bad for students, especially those who are now going into their second year of online learning. I think in terms of content delivery, there's a lot we can do online, but I think there's also a lot that students are missing out on in terms of campus activities and socializing and the life of the university. It's sort of crucial for that experience. So I do feel a lot of sympathy for those who are going into their sort of second or third years now with online teaching.
Oh, I see. So let's move on to the first question then. Since last year and the earlier period of this year, many governments in Asia have claimed that they have successfully prevented the outbreak of COVID-19.Such as India, Indonesia, and Taiwan. India also claimed that they can open the country before they found the new Delta variant and followed by the deadly wave of outbreak. And Indonesia also failed to give the healthcare workers a Sinovac vaccine, which they've proved earlier that it was effective. But later, the vaccine was failed to immune the healthcare workers in the country.And Taiwan also faced a new wave of COVID rising cases despite a very few cases found in the island last year. These cases I mentioned are very similar to the current situation in Asia and Thailand. With this in mind, what do you think about the pandemic situation in Asia right now? And do you think that the Thai government has done good work on managing the current crisis?
Well, it's pretty scary, and this wave more so than the first. And I think that's for several reasons. I mean, firstly, becausethe Delta variant, which is much more transmissible. Secondly, we've got the problem of exhaustion, psychological, economic, political, people are exhausted with the measures that have been imposed to contain the spread of the virus. And then thirdly, also because of challenges with the vaccine rollouts, where there's been huge problems of inequity, right, along geographical lines, along class-based lines, rich countries such as the United States, the United Kingdom, they've been quite successful with their vaccine rollout. But poorer countries in the global south, including here in Asia, have struggled. And there's again, a couple of reasons for this. I mean, for one, we've got Western intellectual property rules. There's been local mismanagement by governments. There's been the ability of elites across the region to protect themselves against the virus, regardless of these failures, by either securing vaccines in country or even kind of engaging in the so-called vaccine tourism, where they fly to, say, the United States to get the best vaccines while people at home can't do that. So what we're seeing is this kind of contributing to greater socio-political fractures in this third wave in terms of the impact of the pandemic. And of course, the poorer and the less powerful in societies are once again bearing the brunt of this.
Oh, yeah. So are you saying that the cause of the third wave, this current wave of the crisis, is mostly from the vaccine inequality in the global south, do you think?
Well, I think that's one of several causes. I mean, this kind of vaccine inequity between north and south and between sort of elites and normal people is one of those contributing factors. But of course, with any kind of complex challenge like a pandemic, there's all sorts of different factors that are feeding into this. But I think the other two that I was drawing attention to there is this idea that, I mean, in the first wave of that vaccine, there was a sense that we're all in this together, and sort of national societies sort of took this almost bunker mentality, where rich and poor alike needed to be protected. But I think what's happening now is that the poor are starting to get exhausted with the heavier burden that they have had to pay in terms of dealing with the first wave, and the elite have been able to get away with sort of accessing many of those protections, whether that's, say, financial markets being bailed out by governments that has protected their wealth, while many small and medium-sized business owners or people working on daily incomes have had their livelihoods destroyed, or whether that's this kind of access to vaccines by, say, political elites who then feel like the pressure is off them a little bit because their own personal health is not a direct threat as it was perhaps in the first wave.
So one other thing about this pandemic is that it exacerbates an already existing social tension. Like, for example, in Thailand, we have the policy on the way of the wave that we would cross in the American labor and construction worker by crossing their camp with little terms of support because they are being seen as spreader of the virus. Despite this, it has been clear that shut-up policy could not slow down the infection rate and only added to the burden of the already marginalized group. Do you think this policy will continue in the future?
Well, sadly, yes, I think it is. I think it will continue in the future. This kind of targeting of marginalized groups is a common response to all sorts of crises, sort of pandemics or otherwise. And it happens both here in Thailand and, of course, elsewhere. Think, for example, about the spike in anti-Asian hate crimes in places like the United States, for example. This and the kind of response to migrant workers in places like Thailand are essentially two sides of the same coin. Historically, in Thailand, migrant workers have been the first to be impacted by any sort of crisis response measures that the state has been implementing. So not just their exodus last year to Myanmar, Cambodia, and Laos, start of the first lockdown, but also in response to, say, the Asian financial crisis in 1997. Migrants were of course, the first to lose their jobs in that situation. Why is this? Well, part of it is this kind of notion that states are primarily obligated to look after their own citizens. So it kind of makes a sort of a ties first policy more palatable to the domestic constituency of the government. Another is that despite contributing immensely to the development of the country, migrants usually have less of a political clout than nationals, however that sort of nationality is constructed. And there's a range of reasons for this, including the socioeconomic status and the immigration status of migrants. And this, of course, makes it much easier to blame them and to follow through with lockdown measures. I mean, it's hard to imagine the same kind of policies that were applied to Samut Sakhon factories and construction camps in Bangkok being used to contain the Tonglo outbreak, for example. You can hardly see the sort of Tonglo elite being sort of surrounded with barbed wire and being brought bread and water, or not, as the case may be. But I think it's important to contest this narrative. I mean, back in December, we'll remember, the outbreak then was blamed on young Thai women. Firstly, those who were crossing the border to work in Myanmar in kind of these kind of shady areas, and those in shady entertainment venues in the center of Bangkok. And then more recently, sort of migrants and refugees that have been fleeing airstrikes on civilians in Myanmar. And there was that sort of whole theater of kind of spraying down the jungles on the Thai-Myanmar border to disinfect from COVID, which was sort of absurd. But I think the hypocrisy here is really quite astounding. And I'm pretty sure that people see it. I mean, for example, I mean, who are paying the Thai women who are crossing the border for their services? I mean, who was it that was raining bombs down on civilians that were causing them to flee? So I think it's important to challenge that narrative that migrants are the problem or that young women are the problem. And because if we challenge that narrative, it might lead us to a very different conclusion as to where the blame lies for these outbreaks. And I think people recognize that.
So another thing is that we have talked about how the domestic response has been very much intervened with the class-based reaction and how it would affect response to the crisis. However, in your article, Corona Crisis in the Mekong, you go further by claiming that the Corona Crisis itself is not simply a natural occurrence or something based on chance, but rather a direct result of the global system of capitalism. Could you explain this point a bit further?
Sure. So I wrote two publications for the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation that were released in January and February this year. And I was trying to look there at these issues of the kind of causes of the corona crisis and some of the impacts of the corona crisis from a different perspective to those that have been dominant. I mean, most analyses of the impact of COVID have taken what we might call a methodologically nationalist approach. For example, by looking at how the impact has been affected or been managed by Thailand, for example. Now, while this is a useful and important, I think it also hides a lot. For example, similar challenges faced by workers in informal sectors across the region, for example, or the utilization of emergency decrees to consolidate authoritarian power from Phnom Penh to Bangkok to Naypyidaw. So there's all sorts of kind of cross-cutting issues that we can highlight here if we try to look beyond that methodological nationalism. So, I mean, firstly, one of the things I tried to do there was to look at the role of capitalism as an underlying structural driver, not only of vulnerabilities to the impact of the virus, but also, as you kind of noted in your question, the emergence of pathogens, these novel pathogens such as COVID-19 themselves. Now, what I was influenced here is by the recent work of a critical epidemiologist, a guy called Rob Wallace, who has long argued that the emergence of novel diseases and the likelihood of these diseases then being transmitted through populations and therefore turning into these hugely disruptive pandemics, such as Ebola or bird flu, and most recently COVID, has been driven by the expansion of capitalism primarily into frontier economies across Africa and Asia, and particularly into sectors like agribusiness. Now, one of the things I argued in both of those publications was that the same dynamics that were at play in terms of the apparent emergence of COVID-19, for example, deforestation driven by land use change for agriculture, for infrastructure, like roads, hydroelectric dams. These are also at play here in the mainland Southeast Asian region. The kind of rates of deforestation in mainland Southeast Asia are terrifying. And with this deforestation, you're forcing, you're kind of undermining biodiversity. You're forcing species such as bats to migrate. This is encouraging spillovers. The expansion of agribusiness and the use of pesticides and hormones and production of kind of the industrial production of food. This is contributing to all sorts of heightened risks of transmission of diseases and spillovers that are contributing to these pandemics such as COVID-19. But on top of that, the papers weren't just about how the emergence of these new viruses were driven by the expansion of capitalism and the development of these frontier markets and agribusiness, but also looking at how policies that have been promoted by multilateral banks like the Asian Development Bank that have been designed to encourage competitiveness, to increase foreign direct investment. But these have actually heightened the vulnerability of the poorest to the kinds of shocks that COVID-19 represents. And they've done this by encouraging states to revise policies, to create favorable conditions for foreign investment, by commodifying land, low corporate taxation, privatization of public services, competitiveness through cheap wages, sort of labor market reforms and the utilization of sort of low-paid women workers in garment industries. All of these sort of dynamics that have been associated with the transformation of the Mekong region to this kind of economic powerhouse, while it has generated these kind of massive levels of economic growth and has contributed to development of infrastructure, it's also come with a dark side. So although we're still in a firefighting mode here with this current third wave, I think we need to keep in mind this much longer term dynamic in the months and years ahead as we start to critically assess the kind of causes and the consequences of the pandemic.
As you say, I also agree that the current crisis also results in the worst condition for the poor, the immigrant, low-paid worker, and it also affects the economy and the environment. So it's very disastrous, yes.
I think what this really shows is that there is not really a division between economic and environment, because or even economic and welfare, because all of these have to function together. Because like we say now, when welfare fails, economy or environment fails, it would also affect economy as well.
Yes, and I think one way of kind of rephrasing the argument that I had in those papers is that this kind of sense of disembodying the market from sort of its environmental and social contexts, this kind of expansion of economic growth, the kind of the single-minded pursuit of GDP expansion, export-led growth, job creation, with relatively little attention paid to the consequences of that for the environment and for the people who are actually doing the hard labor. This is kind of leading us into this kind of very dangerous territory, whereby the conditions of kind of life on this planet are being challenged in terms of the environment, but also the conditions of reproducing sort of healthy, livable societies are also being challenged by this sort of race to the bottom policies of kind of low-cost labor and low corporate taxation and hollowing out of the state. So I think those are different ways of saying the same thing.
Oh, so yeah. So do you think that the Thai government, as you said, like all of this, do you think that the Thai government and all the ASEAN government has faced this crisis for like 1 year and a half now? And do you think so? Does it mean they have failed it badly, right?
Well, I think it's worth kind of giving credit to Thailand as a whole. I consciously use Thailand rather than the Thai government, but to give credit to Thailand as a whole for the effective management of the first wave. I mean, not long ago, Thailand was being championed as one of the global leaders in terms of its pandemic response. But I think it's important not just to credit the government with that. I think a lot of that had to do with this sort of sense of solidarity among Thai people at the time in terms of mask wearing, in terms of listening to advice from public health experts. You didn't see that in the United States. You didn't see that in the United Kingdom. But also, I think, in terms of its public health service. Now, there's a really, really interesting paper by Walden Bellow, who was writing about Thailand's response and looking especially at the role of community public health volunteers and their role in terms of tracking and tracing and their role in terms of public education. And I think it's important to kind of recognize those strengths of Thailand's responses from last year. Even though we're kind of in the sort of darkest depths of despair at the moment, I think it's worth getting credit where it's due. But of course, what a difference 12 months makes. Sitting here in July 2021, it's very different to July 2020, when it seemed to be under control. This kind of third wave is just much more menacing and much more scary, I think. And a lot of that has to do with mismanagement, and it has to do with failures of governance, and it has to do with failures of leadership, and it has to do with failures of institutions that have really washed away all of those gains, those wins that were achieved with the initial response last year.
Yes, last year we have done so. We have passed the COVID-19 crisis so good, but yeah, lastly we failed because the failure of the institution, as you said. So let's move on a little bit to the next question. Apart from the situation in domestic politics and the mismanagement, what do you think about the role of capitalism and the economic corridor in the region that affect the corona crisis? Like you said before, and what do you think will the crisis affect the geo-economic situation of the region in the post-COVID-19 period, such as like the role of China and the relocation of production or relocation of foreign investment?
Well, in terms of that question about the geopolitical impact, things are changing really, really quickly. If we cast our minds back just a few months ago, China was reopening and it was recording these kind of impressive levels of economic growth. And this kind of gave a boost to the so-called China model, with many countries wanting to emulate China while they were kind of looking at the United States and the United Kingdom with disdain. But now what we're seeing is a backlash, right, in the last month or two in particular. Some of this has been unwarranted and borderline racist, part of this so-called new Cold War between the United States and China, whereby China has been blamed for the virus. It also hasn't helped that there's been this perception that Chinese vaccines have a much lower efficacy, especially against the Delta variant that's currently running rampant in the region. I mean, it's important to also, again, giving credit where it's due, Chinese vaccines have been the ones that were more accessible than others. And on the one hand, this is good, and this is something that China deserves credit for. Western intellectual property protections hampered access to others. It simply wasn't affordable for many countries to have access to, say, the Pfizer or Moderna or Johnson & Johnson. And China's vaccines are affordable and have filled that necessary gap. So I think it's important to kind of recognize that there's kind of two sides to this. Then on the other side, there's this suspicion about why governments have still been choosing these vaccines that more and more data is showing are less are less useful against the Delta variant, when others have been available and have not necessarily been more expensive and indeed been cheaper than these ones. So I think there's that issue in terms of this kind of backlash against China as a result of this pandemic. Another one that I think we need to recognize in the region is this huge PR disaster for China in terms of the international support that they've been giving to what can only be described as a terrorist neo-fascist regime in Myanmar. Right? And this is something that has massively damaged China's reputation, not just in Myanmar, but across the region amongst people who do not agree with the sort of authoritarian approach to politics taken by Beijing, or who are frustrated with the sort of roadblocks that have been put in place to achieving some kind of international consensus, or the kind of the dithering response from ASEAN states to the Myanmar crisis. I mean, this is all generating this kind of backlash that is undermining the social capital that I think China had managed to build in the first few months of 2021, that's starting to evaporate. So we've got this issue, firstly, of the so-called China model, firstly coming out of this pandemic as being something that other countries would want to emulate. China also managed to gain international goodwill with this accessibility of their vaccines, but a lot of that is now being undone, I think, in the last couple of months. And that impact, that sort of impact isn't, again, it's kind of important, I think, to not be constrained by this methodologically nationalist point of view, whereby you might say, well, the relationship between, say, Thailand and China has changed, or Myanmar and China has changed. I think it's much more important to kind of look at this in terms of the kind of different axes, such as generational, ideological, class-based lines, when it comes to the acceleration of these sort of social factors. I mean, in societies across the region, there are people and groups and institutions that want to benefit from closer ties with China, or indeed ones who recognize that they can't avoid but having closer ties with China, and those who cannot abide what they regard as China's pernicious influence. And all of these are split along generational, ideological, and class-based lines, which is contributing to this very kind of complex picture.
Okay, so yeah, as you said, I think I also think that it's like China also try to use its Chinese vaccine as a PR to gain back their reputation from being the starter of the crisis. Yeah. So let's move on to next question.
So we need to talk about long term, but we already talked a bit about geopolitics, as you say in the question, but what do you think would happen in terms of the economic? Like say, what do you think would be the effect of the current crisis on the global capitalist system in general and the economic corridor in particular? Do you think I'm more concerned over the need to control our border would result in another configuration of global capitalist system?
Okay. And yeah, I think this is an important question and something we need to start questioning. And lots of people have, right? There's been people arguing that this sort of old period of neoliberal globalization, this kind of expansion of kind of market forces, sort of freed from the constraints of kind of national states, contributing to, say, regulatory harmonization, the lifting of tariff and non-tariff barriers to trade, the development of infrastructure such as economic corridors to facilitate this disaggregation of production, these kind of global and regional supply chains. That's all coming under question since the pandemic. And some have argued that we're moving from this sort of stage of a global neoliberalism to a return of a form of sort of national capitalism, or perhaps more accurately, state capitalism. I mean, for example, we've got there's a very famous sociologist, Zygmunt Bauman, who argued that one of the hallmarks of contemporary capitalism is that it has this sort of escapist impulse. It constantly wants to shirk its responsibilities to the communities on which it preys. And the whole transformation of the global political economy since the 1970s onwards, and then accelerated under this period of hyper-globalization from the late 1990s onwards, all of that was about empowering forces of capital. But what we're seeing now, I think, with the vulnerabilities that this has left us with, both in terms of the vulnerabilities of capital to disruptions within these global supply chains, but also the vulnerabilities of people, those kind of countries that were unable to close themselves down and to lock down to contain the spread of the virus, were the ones who often had these more virulent strains coming through. When we look at the United Kingdom, for example, they kind of didn't stop flights from somewhere like China until very, very late in the day. And you were still having sort of tens of thousands of people flying in and out of London all the way through the pandemic. And that's because London is it's a kind of a very global city. I mean, Bangkok is also a very global city, but still you had this sort of shutdown of the economy in Thailand that led to this ability to protect public health in a way. And I think there's this kind of reassessment of the kind of risks and vulnerabilities of this this old phase of globalization. And so what comes next is the question. And I think that's something we'll be asking ourselves in the years to come.
So let's return to Thailand. Do you think the current strategy of the Thai government on extending the state emergency also has a hidden agenda to curb down the protests as well? And do you think the government is now upset with exercising authoritative power rather than dealing with the crisis by using the pandemic as a means to maintain stability? Because like there are so many unrest going on in Thailand right now, and many Asian countries also protesting their government for Chinese vaccine too, as we can see from many recently media and social platform. The young people are now protesting. Yes, what do you think about this issue?
Well, I think that's a difficult question because I'm not privy to a lot of the information that some of the politicians might be privy to. But I think we can certainly make the observation that this sort of state of emergency legislation that I think was introduced in 2005, the over-reliance on these sorts of emergency measures reveals something, I think, about the ability of a state to manage the crises it faces. Now, without kind of piling on Thailand too much here, I mean, it's worth also kind of noting that in during the so-called War on Terror after 2001 through the sort of mid to late 2000s, we had these sorts of emergency powers being implemented across the world, the United States, the United Kingdom, across Northern Europe, and of course across the global South. And there's been pushback against those. But what it really kind of signifies, I think, is the inability of the state to deal with the crises unless it's given these exceptional powers. And you start to have this kind of mission creep whereby the state and kind of people managing the state become increasingly reliant on those extra powers, which then contributes to the sort of atrophy of the state's institutions. So just as during lockdown, if we're not doing any exercise, our muscles will atrophy and waste away. Just in a similar vein, you've got the institutions of the state, the ministries of public health, the ministries of labor, the kind of institutions using different sort of arms of the law to deal with public health issues. If we use legislation such as the emergency decree, which centralizes a lot of power under the office of the prime minister, under the executive, being over-reliant on that, you start to see the weakening of the other organs of the state. So there's that one comment to make, or one observation to make there. I think another observation to make is that it also kind of signifies that it can be that these emergency powers are used to confront the emergencies that they're supposed to be confronting, such as a public health crisis. But those powers can also be used for other means, for kind of shutting down parliament or for imposing freedom restrictions on freedom of speech. And now once that's in place, it's very difficult to hold those institutions to account for the way that they use those powers. And I think in the case of Thailand, I mean, let's not forget we were under the sort of NCPO from 2014 to 2019, and most of that was also under an emergency decree. I think if we look at the amount of time that you have what might be called normal politics or politics where the emergency decree was not in place, we'll probably find that more often than not, there's been an emergency decree in place, which encourages and facilitates this reliance on it as a sort of normal operating procedure, which is very dangerous, I think, to the health of a society and its institutions as a whole.
So, do you think this sort of the condition of this sort of measure can get without tangible improvement to the situation and without sufficient disease effort, would it result in the greater support for the movement against the current government, or would the democratic movement be stubborn out?
Well, I think there's a couple of points to be made here. I mean, on the one hand, if these emergency measures are necessary and they are accompanied by support for people who've been affected by the lockdown, such as through the sort of expediting of stimulus packages or kind of assistance for people who are losing their income and their livelihoods, or such as lockdowns that may in some cases be necessary. I think there is a case to be made that these emergency powers can be useful. But I think it's also a double-edged sword. I mean, once you start to concentrate power in the hands of one person or the office of one organization, well, with that power comes a certain degree of responsibility or an expectation of accountability. And if that accountability isn't forthcoming or if that responsibility isn't demonstrated, it's kind of very clear to people where the power lies, where the buck stops. So I think that's an important point to make there. In terms of this broader issue of how the handling of the crisis has been managed by the regime and whether this is going to contribute to greater unrest or greater support for people opposing the government, this is quite hard to say. I mean, there's, on the one hand, there's this very kind of tenuous claim made by the regime to national leadership since 2014, and then, of course, reinforced with the 2019 general election. That claim to leadership has been undermined in the past year. That claim to electoral legitimacy was already being challenged last year in the streets. But since then, the management of the country has brought them increasing scrutiny. Firstly, the economy is in a dire state, and the real threat to the Thai people is the virus and the loss of livelihoods, not the youth who are being confronted on the streets. Yet questions can be made and have been asked about how effective government measures have been to confront these threats. I mean, for example, this COVID stimulus that was authorized by Parliament led to the massive expansion of public debt. To what extent has that expansion of public debt contributed to the economy? Has it kind of kept it on life support? Has it reinvigorated it? Or has a lot of that been wasted? Secondly, how effective are things like submarines and anti-riot vehicles for protecting people against the pandemic? I mean, surely priority should be placed on vaccines, and that's where money should be spent. I think the main challenge for people who would criticize the government is not just to oppose that regime and to expose their failings, but to offer an alternative vision, an alternative strategy that might genuinely contribute to the well-being of all Thai people. Because what we've got is this kind of very polarized society where people are divided along sort of generational lines, along class-based lines, along ideological lines, along lines related to what they consider to be the source and legitimacy of the nation. The challenge, I think, is to how to transcend those divisions and contribute to the well-being of everybody, regardless of these different points of view, whether pro-establishment or pro-democracy. I think the problem, however, is that the political system in this country has been weakened so as to undermine the possibility of this actually happening. I mean, I'm not just talking about the dissolution of Future Forward here. It's a much bigger structural issue. Real power doesn't lie with the people or with representatives of the people, but with the executive, or at least nominally. And that power with the executive has been increased with these emergency decrees.
Do you think the current strategy the protesters have been used against the government is an effective one, or what should there be a change in the strategy?
Well, I have to be careful here as a foreigner who's made Thailand my home. Of course, I have my political views, but as a non-citizen, I have no right to try to influence Thai politics, and it wouldn't be welcomed by many if I did. I mean, I also wouldn't sort of deign to advise protesters on strategy. I think they've demonstrated that there are some very astute strategists in the movement. One thing I would say, though, is that protesters really do face quite a daunting challenge. Although the regime doesn't enjoy much popular support, there are some very powerful establishment interests that are invested in the status quo. And they have money, they have weapons, access to the machinery of the state. But at the same time, the persistence and bravery of the protesters, and along with the youth, and the fact that they are so young, means that opposition to the regime is not going to fade away. So we have sort of two vehicles here on a railroad collision. I think the challenge for Thailand, the country as a whole, is how to overcome these divides and make sure that the very substantial resources that Thailand enjoys, which include its youth, can be harnessed in a way that could benefit the country as a whole, but also in a way that political divisions and differences of opinion, differences of ideology, differences of political orientation, which are natural to any society, are handled in sort of a productive manner, and doesn't can keep coming back to these street protests and these clashes between people and the authorities that have been sort of blighting Thai politics for 15 years or more.
Oh, okay. Before closing up, I want to add up a little bit. Go back a little bit. I have some question myself. Like, so are you saying that the state of emergency is also necessary for the management of the crisis right now?
Well, I think there are certain circumstances in which a state of emergency can be justified. I think the problem is that the use of a state of emergency legislation for so much of the country's political history means that the institutions that should be relied upon to deal with the crisis now have been weakened over a very long period of time. I'm thinking here of, say, the bureaucracy or the Ministry of Public Health. I mean, if different branches of government cannot work together in normal times, if you've got this sort of siloization that the state of emergency is supposed to overcome, well, that's not fixing the problem of not being able to work together. And then becoming increasingly reliant on the centralization of powers to fix all crises means that this state of emergency will continue to be invoked, and all the while, rather than sort of exercising those parts of the government that should be empowered to deal with problems and indeed crises when they become problems of that magnitude, it starts to eat away at the very organization, the very organism that is supposed to protect us. There's this sort of autoimmunity disease. An autoimmune disease is when the body's when a human body's antibodies start attacking healthy cells.
And I want to just add some of the thing that I missed. I just want to ask you a little bit about why do you think that Thailand and the current government in Asian countries right now still rely on the Chinese vaccine, even its efficacy is now in question? And also, why do you think that the Thai government rely on the method of mixing the vaccine right now?
Well, again, this is another issue that I'm going to have to be very cautious about, because obviously the sensitivities around the management and the procurement of the vaccine have kind of landed some with some very serious legal charges. But I think there's, to kind of reiterate the point that I was making earlier, I think there's a couple of things to point out. On the one hand, the Chinese vaccines were much more accessible. Right, they were being rolled out. They were cheaper. There's been all these kind of blocks on the on technology transfer in terms of the expansion of these more kind of respective vaccines. Countries such as the U.S., United Kingdom, Germany, they've all been sort of blocking these attempts that have been made at a multilateral level to try to expand access to the so-called Western vaccines. So I think it's important not to let Western countries off the hook here. At the same time, I think it's also important not to let host countries off the hook too. I mean, we've got, there are kind of programs such as COVAX, for example, that Thailand decided not to join for sort of unspecified reasons. I think in terms of this idea of trying to establish local production of the AstraZeneca virus, I think in principle that was also a really good idea, right? To be able to encourage this technology transfer and encourage this kind of local production of something that could be tooled as a public good across the region. However, as we're kind of well aware, there have been challenges with this that we're not really allowed to talk about openly and honestly. Now, the backlash against here is then to kind of say, well, it's a problem with the Chinese vaccine, or it's a problem with Sinopharm or whatever. But I think that's to take it out of context, or to kind of pin the blame on one cause rather than sort of a complex conjunction of different dynamics that have conspired to reinforce this inequity of vaccine distribution, both between global north and global south, but also between the wealthy and the poor within societies and those who are able to, say, fly abroad for vaccines. I mean, I'm not just talking about expatriates and friends of mine who have kind of flown back to the United Kingdom, to Australia, to the United States. Well, not Australia. I can't think of someone in that case, but certainly to the United Kingdom and to the United States to get vaccines. I know there are also Thais who've flown to the United States to get vaccines. What that does is to kind of relieve a little bit of pressure on the government to sort their own vaccine management out, because the people who have the power and influence to perhaps change that policy or influence that policy are the ones who are looking after themselves. Understandably so. I mean, when the state fails, people look after themselves. But at the same time, that's sort of a pressure release valve, in the sense that you have elites who, rather than doing everything they can to strengthen a national pandemic response and national health systems, use their privilege to sort of run away from those systems and look after themselves. So there's all sorts of interesting dynamics, I think, that this kind of vaccine politics raises.
Indeed, yes. So as you said, there are many red lines on this issue. And when we talk about it, the vaccine issue now is like, it has turned into a political issue right now. Yeah,
absolutely. And I think one more thing to note is that there's also this rising vaccine hesitancy. I think there were surveys that were conducted last year that indicated that Thailand was the most vaccine positive country in the world, by which is meant that respondents in Thailand were the most enthusiastic about getting a vaccine when it became available. That's changed a lot in the last 12 months, I think. And at least from anecdotal evidence, people I've been speaking to, there's a lot of hesitancy now about whether about what vaccines are available. What are some of the what might be some of the what might be you know, whether which vaccines are the best? Whether they're going to hold up for ones that they perceive to be better than others? Whether they trust the vaccines that are being produced and given, and whether or not they're going to take a wait and see approach. And all of this conspires to undermine this effort of so-called herd immunity, whereby you can get most of the population vaccinated so that the impacts of the pandemic are more manageable in order that some kind of return to normality might happen. So I think that issue of vaccine hesitancy is also one of growing concern, and that reflects a sort of distrust in institutions and distrust in the management of the vaccine rollout.
Okay, so I think that's the last question. Finally, thank you, Ajahn Chali, for being here and sharing such valuable knowledge with us. Today, we have learned so many things on the economic dimension of the current wave of the COVID-19 crisis in the region, including its relation with the internal politics of Thailand and ASEAN countries. Ajahn Chali also gave us many interesting insights on the issue of the state of emergency. Ajahn Chali also mentioned some of Marxism and economic corridors, globalization, vaccine inequality, and also the vaccine politics. So thank you again, and we really appreciate your time for being here with us.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for inviting me, and it's been fun to discuss these issues with you.
ท่านสามารถรับฟังเนื้อหาดีๆจากศูนย์วิจัยดิเรกชัยนามได้ทางดิเรกพอดแคสต์ผ่านช่องทาง SoundCloud และ Spotify รวมทั้งยังสามารถติดตามความเคลื่อนไหวและสาระดีๆจากพวกเราได้ทาง Facebook ดิเรกชัยนาม Research Center